All right, hello and welcome to video number 8, in which I will show you an example data analysis, and I think we will even get to building a small little app using the R package Shiny. So without further ado, let's jump into R Studio, which I already decorated nicely because Garrick Aidan Bui wrote an R package called RS Themes. And in there, you can find a bunch of themes. They are nicely displayed on its GitHub page here, for example. And one of these themes is Christmas themed, so we even get a decoration for our environment panel. So I'm ready to jump straight in. I will leave the link in the script in which I will be working, so you can check it out as well. I will also be using our Markdown again for our exploratory data analysis. There's one cool thing I wanted to show you, which I use all the time because I use our Markdown for basically every output format that I do. If I write research reports or other things, I usually use our Markdown even if I don't need the R code. Because from our Markdown, as you have already seen, you can produce a bunch of output formats. This one here, it produces a website, for example. The whole course website is produced with our Markdown. All the slides are produced with a special R Markdown format from the Saringan package, for example. And you can find all these R Markdown formats in the link I will be providing in the script, which is a link to the R Markdown book written by Yihui himself, who wrote the original Nittera package and is working on R Markdown. And a bunch of really cool things, for example, Saringan. Or Sharingan, I've probably butchered the name, I'm sorry. This one created the slides. If you are at some point looking to, for example, submit to an academic journal, there is the articles package, which should have a link to the package as well. Think I have one in here. And this provides output formats for various journals, the way they accept their research papers. So if you have these packages installed and then you make a new R Markdown document, you will be able to go here from template. And then you can say, for example, I want to submit to Springer or the Still article, which is a machine learning journal and the format I use for the website. And the other cool things, for example, the Ninja presentation is what I used for the presentations. One little note, a lot of these articles are based on PDF, so they will give you a LaTeX output. And in order to get a PDF from LaTeX, you will need LaTeX installed. However, installing LaTeX can sometimes be not a lot of fun, let me tell you that. And for this, we are lucky that the same guy who wrote the Nitter and the R Markdown package, and well, who wrote Nitter and is working on the Markdown, also wrote a package to automatically install LaTeX and all the packages that come with it. It's called TinyTeX. It's an R package, but it installs LaTeX for you. So you can do everything from R without worrying about the other stuff, which I find is a general theme of R packages. They tend to make really easy to do everything from R without having to worry about all these weird, complicated things around it, which I think is really nice. It's a very thoughtful approach to developing packages. So yeah, thank you, R community. Speaking of R community, I wanted to also say point you to a way of finding help easier. And this is the RepRex package. RepRex stands for reproducible example. And the idea is when you are looking for help on some forum, for example, you want to try and give them all the code they need to reproduce your problem. So you want to make a minimal example, and the RepRex package can help you in doing so. Basically, what you do is you write some code, and then the RepRex package will give you a Markdown formatted code and output of your code, so you can ask people, hey, what's going on here? And the Reprex package will make sure you use it on code that actually contains everything that is necessary to reproduce the problem. All right, so this should prepare you nicely for your further R journey after this course is over. And one thing I also didn't mention yet is that I have been using the preview version of RStudio, so essentially the next version of RStudio that will be coming out, which is version 1.4. And of course, in preview versions, there are sometimes some bugs, things don't work quite out. But it's also really nice that you can help the people developing RStudio, and they're giving it away for free, so I can help them a bit by finding these bugs before they get into the production version, which I think is actually quite nice. And the perks is you also get to see these cool features that will come to the next version. One of these might interest you, because when you're not too familiar with code, all this markdown stuff might feel a bit unfamiliar. I like it because I like this plain text format, but in the preview version of RStudio, which I linked to an article here, you get a couple of things. You get this button up here, which is the visual markdown editor. And this will format the markdown the way it will basically look in the output format. So you don't have, and you can even get these features that you have in Word or other text editors, for example. And even cooler, you can insert citations straight from a citation manager called Zotero, which I also really recommend. You can find it on zotero.org. The main reason I recommend it is it's open source, and that means the source code is available. Even if it's at some point in the future it goes away, you can, like, someone will always have the source code. So this will never truly go away. You can always use it. Which, as opposed to other software where you need to, for example, pay a yearly license, for example. So even though you will get licenses for some citation managers from your university, maybe, you will not be able to use those after you've finished your studies. Whereas for Zotero, you can always use it and it's fully functional and featured. And I can insert citations in our markdown straight from Zotero, it's just really cool. Okay, with this workflow stuff out of the way, let's actually get out of visual mode for now, because I just like seeing the plain code. The visual mode is also really cool because it shows you previews of pictures straight away. So let's get into the unknown and analyze some unseen data. I have this link here, which a couple of people want to look into, and this is on fast food data. The data comes from fastfoodnutrition.com, where we have the nutrition information for a bunch of these meals, if you can call these meals, I don't know. So, like, calories and calories from fat. And I think the person who collected the data used some web scraping techniques to get this data. However, it's only the entrees, if you pronounce it that way. And we could download more, but the website owner asked to remove this web scraping guide, so I assume they weren't too happy with all the web scraping. So we're not going to do that, but we will use web scraping on another website to get some more info. So let's look at the actual data first. And I will actually just download it straight into R. I go to the raw data and copy this line here. And now let me move this out of the way. And let's hope our studio doesn't crash again. Like I said, I like using the preview version, and sometimes it doesn't like when I do screen recordings. Okay, so I'm back in here. We are analyzing fast food data. And I think what I will be doing is actually download the file for us so we can work with it offline, because I actually don't have the best internet connection here, so I want to make sure I have it in case the connection crashes again. So we download the data. All right, this is done. I'm actually removing this line because I have the source of the data as a link here, so you don't need to have that line in the final script. And now we can read the data. I will be using the tidyverse for this. Actually, let me take this line and move it just up here. And this makes sure that I can see straight away which libraries I'm using in the script to make it a bit more organized. All right, and now let's get our data. Let's call it fast food. So we're using read CSV. I think it was comma separated. If not, we are in for a surprise. I save it in the data folder and call it fastfood.csv. And let's look at it straight away. All right, this is looking good. We got this unnamed column, which is automatically named x1. It is just the index of the column. And we have the restaurant and the item. And then I assume for each item, we have the calories that are composed of fat, the total amount of fat, saturated fat, trans fat, cholesterol, sodium, oh boy, yeah. Total carbohydrates, fiber, sugar, protein, vitamin A, vitamin C, calcium, salad. I don't actually know what the salad column is. Let me check a couple of things. First, I want to know how many different restaurants are there. All right, it's 8 rows, so 8 restaurants, and they have varying amounts of items. So we have, for example, 115 items from Taco Bell, but only 42 from Dairy Queen. And I think these are, I guess, American things, so some of them, I think, are not here in Germany. Now, what's up with the salad thing? Now, if I were to turn this into a final like report, for example, I would later go over and see which things I actually want in my output and add some comments in here in the just some text for the markdown. So what's up with the salad column? It's actually all other. So this is not very helpful. Just salad all the way. So let me, when I read this in, just remove the salad column. I don't think it provides any useful information. And the X1 column is also no useful information because I think they, let me actually check this. It's 515 rows in total. What happens if I go how many distinct combinations of restaurant and item do we have? It's 513. So these already uniquely identify each item. So we don't, oh no, wait a second, they don't. It's 515. So one of them seems to be doubled. So let's keep the X1 for now. And let's see which one is doubled. So we need to sort to see which one is doubled. Okay, Taco Bell. Okay, we got the chili cheese burrito twice, and we also have the express taco salad with chips twice. But we need them only once. So another data quality thing that I will add to our data cleaning steps. I want to only keep distinct combinations of restaurant and item, but I want to keep all columns, not just the restaurant and item columns. On that note, you can also use the abbreviation T and F for true and false. However, while true and false are reserved words, so you can't override those, you could override this variable T. So it's not a reserved word. It's just normally assigned to true. So it's safer to always use true, because sometimes, for example, in a script, you might want to use T for the temperature. And then you will be really confused if you thought T was true and not some temperature, for example. And now we also don't actually need the x1 column anymore. Okay, now we got some cleaner data. Good. This reduced the count for Taco Bell a bit. I'll actually leave this in so I can add some comments later as to what we did here and why we did it. We could have called the initial data like raw fast food and then tidied fast food, but in this case, let's just leave it at that, because, well, I explained everything in the video already. Okay, now what I would like to do is make some plots, I think. And there's a bunch of features that we could turn into a plot. And I actually want to know how the distribution of all these features looks like and just look at all of them at the same time. So now what I'm doing is I'm breaking the tidy data principle, because, well, this data is already tidy, but let's break down into something that is not tidy in order to look at it from a different point of view. Because right now, what the only thing I could do, for example, is plot maybe like the relationship of calories and fat, for example, to each other, and use all these as dimensions of our data. But I want to display these dimensions in a different way. Actually, I realize I still have the x1 column, so maybe I didn't run this. Oh, right. Minus x1. Here we go. Now this is looking good. Yep. Same unit combinations. So what I want to do is use pivot longer. And now I get everything but the restaurant. And the item. So the rest should be all the features of the items. Yes. Okay. So we get the name of the feature and the value of the feature. And this enables us to create a pretty cool plot where we just put, actually, yeah, I think I have an idea. Let's put the value on here and use the color to be the restaurant. Let's see how it turns out. And then I'm using geom. Let's start out with the histogram. And now we facet wrap by the name of the feature. This will look really weird because they are different features, so they have different scales. So we should probably say each of these little subplots can have both scales free. Now there's also more things happening because we are using a histogram and we have different colors. They are all stacking on top of each other. So this is maybe not what we want. In order to compare these, now it looks like, for example, Burger King is on top, but it's just stacked on top of all of these. It's not higher values. Let's use density to estimate densities from those. And these don't stack, so we can compare them easier. Okay, it's still kind of hard to see with all these different lines. All right, so I have an idea. Let's look at these individually per restaurant. So let's first get the individual restaurants out. So restaurants are going to be all unique values of the restaurant column in the data set. So we got these restaurants. So before, after, it doesn't really matter. We just filter the data so that the restaurant column equals the let's say the first in our restaurants. So this is just going to be McDonald's. And now it. Oh, yeah. Our studio doesn't like it when I save while I run this plot. Okay, and now we only get lines for one restaurant. And we can easier compare these distributions. And if we choose a different restaurant, we get the plot for the different restaurant. Okay. Now I think I've sort of promised that we would do some web scraping. So let's actually do some web scraping now so we can augment our data and our understanding of the data with more information. And for this, I will be using the Arvest package, which a bit like harvesting. Yeah, so you're harvesting data. And this enables us to read HTML from websites and extract useful information from it. So the general idea of taking data out of text and turning it into useful information is called parsing. So we are parsing HTML. Let's see if I have it installed. I do have it installed. So this is good. Now I will actually go up here. And load the whole library. And one idea I had when I saw that you were interested in this fast food data set was maybe we can get some ratings for these restaurants. So let's look at fast food restaurant ratings. I already searched for that. There's TripAdvisor. That's best fast. Maybe that's not too good. Okay, this is looking like there's no information on here. I know we have Burger King here. It's good. We do have Taco Bell, McDonald's, okay. Well, let's see what information we have here. All right, so these are not actually ratings, they are complaints. It's a website where you can send in complaints. Maybe we can extract some data about what people complain about the most for a certain fast food restaurant. Yeah, this is actually something I think we can do. Okay. And there's more pages. Okay, so one thing I'm looking at when I click this like next button is how does the link for the page change? So I think I should actually be able to just go to some other page without clicking the link by just inserting it right in here. And now like Burger King, this is pretty predictable. I don't know what this B something does. I wonder if we can actually find this page without this. Okay, so it automatically completes this here. So this website leads, so even though I just press in Burger, type in Burger King here, it leads to this website. And I think let's check for the others. Burger King and Taco Bell. There's another be weird thing. I don't think we need it. Yeah, we don't. So if I just type Taco Bell, /page/2, well, let's go on. Yeah, this leads to this one. And Taco Bell page, let's use 10. Now, it loads for a while, but I think it worked. What happens if we use a page that doesn't exist? 100? Okay, apparently it does exist. There's a bunch of complaints here. Let's go to 1000. Okay, then I just end up back at 1. So we probably shouldn't go too high, otherwise we just get duplicate data all the time. So I think what I want to get is this text here. I think it will be a bit too much to ask to get the full review because for this we will need to follow an additional link. We could do, but this will just... actually, there's one thing we could do. A lot of websites have this file called robots.txt, which tells robots what they are allowed to do and what they are not allowed to do. However, there's nothing here, I think, that tells me I can't web scrape it. And we are actually not doing very heavy web scraping. We are just downloading the HTML, so it will look a bit like normal user browsing, it's just very fast. Should be fine. Okay. So let's see if we can construct the names that we will need. And I think I just do this manually, it's not too many. So because for Taco Bell, we got Taco Bell. Let's use Taco Bell in here. First thing we're going to do is download the HTML files from one of these and see how it looks like. And we already know how we can construct these URLs. So let's actually create one URL. So this is going to be this part here. Oh, and I realize I think this will be much more fun using the glue package. So now we can construct links way easier. Let's move this over here. There's some nice space and get our Christmas decoration up here. Okay. So we got complaints, Subway. And I think we know it's going to be Subway/page/some number. Let's call it n. Let's set n at 1 for now. And in here we just make the restaurant name. Which one is Subway? The last one. Number 8. So we get this URL, and I forgot to wrap it in glue, which sounds funny. Just wrap it in glue. And now let's look at this URL. If I copy and paste it, let's see if we land where we think we will land. And we land at the page for Subway. Okay. Perfect. That's actually perfect. So what we want to do is use the read.html file, read.html function from the rvis package. And it takes a URL, so we just call it URL. So this should be fine. And now we have a bunch of HTML code. For those that haven't seen this before, we look at it here, and now I will open the developer tools. So you go up here. This is the Brave browser. If it looks, it's based on Chromium, just without advertisement and the Google stuff. It should look the same on Chrome, a bit different on Firefox, but there should be. I use the shortcut all the time, which why don't more tools? Yeah. And there's developer tools and more tools, which you can open with Control Shift I. And this shows you the source code of the website. Because basically, all the website does is gives you the source code, and then the job of your browser is to display it. So there's the HTML. And in here, we have the CSS, which defines how the HTML is supposed to look. And if we right click on something and go inspect, we find the correct HTML element for this. And what we want to do is find what is called CSS selector, which selects these pieces of text so we can download them and not everything. Well, we download everything, but we want to extract these pieces of text. And there's something really handy, which is an extension called Selector Gadget. And you can install it from, for example, the Google Chrome App Store. And there might also be something for Firefox, I don't know. So Selector Gadget, and then we click on the things we want to select. And it highlights everything that it would select. If there's something that is selected that we don't want to select, we can click on this again and to remove it from this selection. So, and we can add more things to our selection. And down here we get this CSS selector. So let me copy this. This is what we want. Now I can go and select an HTML node, or rather, no. Multiple HTML nodes. And in here it says it takes a CSS selector. So this is the selector. And now we get a node set, which is 20. Should be 20. That's good. Sounds good. Which is these 20 texts and nothing else. Maybe we want to also add these things here, but let's go with the text for now. And unfortunately, it's only the start of the text. If we wanted more, we would need to find a way to generate the links to the full reviews, which actually we could just check if this is an easy thing to do. I think they are grouped by where the subway is, which so we would need to get all the locations of subways and then generate these links from this. Or we would need to write sort of a bot that goes on this website and then finds all the read full review links and clicks on them, which is something we could do. It would just take a bit more time and it would also run for longer. Let's go for the easy approach for now. Okay, and so this is this node list. And there's some text in here. I call this subway location all the time and nobody answered the phone. Which, okay, it's maybe weird that you're calling a subway all the time, but Maybe they think you're a stalker. And then you can use HTML text to get the text from these nodes. And now we get a vector, a just normal R vector of text, the character vector. I think it's even more text than I... Yeah, sometimes it stops at dot dot dot. But sometimes it's quite a lot of text. So we do get some information, it's just the first couple of sentences, but let's assume the first couple of sentences are the most important to people, because that's why they put them first. So let's work with those and see what we get. Let's call these complaints. So we get a bunch of these complaints here. Worst eating experience ever. These backslash n stands for a new line. It's just a formatting thing. And then what we could do, I think, is from the tidy text package, is turn it into words. Yeah, we will do this. So this is getting to be fun. Okay. I have an idea. So let's do this process and just turn it into a function. GetComplaints is a function that takes a URL. And it does exactly this here. So only this. And just returns it straight away. So we can basically get these complaints using the function getComplaints on the URL we just created. And it still works. Okay. Now we need a way of constructing all these URLs. And I think this is not vectorized by default, so we can only get one HTML page at a time. So we will need to use the per package to map over a bunch of things. Oops. So let's create okay, I got it. Let's create the crossing of all restaurant names and let's call this restaurant. So we match the restaurant column name up in our other data set. And let's get the first one to let's go with 50. Well, let's go with, I don't know how many they have for each other. Let's go with 30 for now, just to test it. So this will generate all combinations of the restaurant and the numbers. And this means we can create a new column that we call URL, and this is just this here. And this is a restaurant, and this is n in this case. And I think I forgot this. So we get these URLs that we created. We can check any one of these to see if it works. Copy, paste. And now we're at Arby's, page 7. Okay, perfect. Arby's is anti-constitution. I did not know that. Okay. Terrible service. Food items backed at drive-thru. Arby's fish sandwich. Okay. I received a bread toy in my roast beef and cheddar sandwich. Oh, why? I guess yes, it's actually pretty funny to read just by themselves. So the next step is to get these complaints. And we will get them using the map function. And we want to map over the URL the function get complaints. And let's not forget to save this. Alright, I actually paused the video for a minute or two here. This might be faster or slower depending on your internet connection. Let's look at all the complaints that we got. Yes, this is good. We're looking at 3,300 complaints. And the reason I have it in this format is I want to use the tidy text package by I think Julia Silge and Dave Robertson. Or David? Sorry. I need to look up the name again. So we're using the tidy text package to unnest the text column, which is going to be our complaints, into what text analysis people call tokens. So it's the output column to be created. Oh, this is the input column. And now output is going to be, let's call it word, and the token is words. So we're actually splitting by everything that is white space and all that. Oh, it's words, not works. And now we get each individual word. And we can I think there's a tidy text function to remove stop words. Oh no, there's just a data set of stop words, but we can do anti-join and anti-join with the tidy text. Stop words. Let's see how these look like. All right, looks like Maya Studio crashed here, and I'm not going to make the same mistake again. And this time, I am going to write this out as a CSV file. Okay. Got our complaints and they are saved here, so we can safely load them and look at them. It's a list. Yep, and we got 20 in each. It's perfect. Let's look at the stop words. It's a word and which lexicon it came from. So what it will do is remove all these stop words, which are just really common words. Something looking weird about this output. And now it's only the less common words in here. And we have one word per row. But root, for example. There's some numbers in there. Okay. And then what we can do is, for example, group by the restaurant. And count the word. Actually, we can just count restaurant in a word. And then we'll see which words are more common for which restaurant. Okay, so the first most common word is apparently the name of the restaurant. Most common words and complaints for Dairy Queen, which is not dairy or queen, is time. Arby's seem to have a problem with their manager. Oh, and food seems to be a problem in Dairy Queen and McDonald's. Blizzard, I don't know what that has to do with the Dairy Queen. Customer manager ice cream. Time seems to be a thing. Window. Root. Root is a thing. Cheese. And let's actually just keep the top something. It's superseded. So new word would be slice max. Order by N, but we want this per restaurant. All right, so we order by N and then get the top 15 per restaurant. Let's call it top complaints. And maybe we can turn this into a little visualization as well. Let's do this for one restaurant for now. Oh, and let's we need to match up the restaurant names with the need to match up these restaurant names. With these restaurant names. So let's okay. All right, let's do it like this. So we have these restaurant names. And we have we got the restaurants and the restaurants' names. And let's match them up. First one is McDonald's. Taco Bell's last. And I think this is the only thing we changed. McDonald's, Chick-fil-A, Sonic, Arby's, Burger King. So this should give us a match. Wait, this doesn't work. Oh, right. Why did I delete it? Just one comma too much. Now it works. Let's put this where we have the original restaurant names. Now we need to make sure we replace this restaurant. The correct restaurant name. So we don't want Sonic Drive-In, we want just Sonic, for example. So we are going over here. And left join the names. And we are joining by, the restaurant is going to be the restaurant names, actually. Now we have the restaurant column and the restaurants column, and they are matched up. However, I think we wanted to call it just, well, this is the name we wanted to use. So let's remove this column. And rename the other column to be, to get this name. Oh, we can't remove it because it's still grouped by it. Oh my, this was quite a journey just for this simple thing. But now we finally have our dog complaints. And let me put this up here. And just do this in here, just in one step. Up here. And this restaurant column should now be the same as in the fast food column. Okay, should get the same names. Now we can actually do what I intended to do, and that is building an app. And in order to build an app, it's of course going to be a very shiny app, not just because it looks shiny, but because we will be using the R package shiny. The website for Shiny. Let me include a link in here. And if you have installed the package, we can just go in here, create a new Shiny web app. Just call it app.r and create it right in Lecture 8. And what this will do is give us this file called app.r. And up here we have this run app button. And it will run the app. It's just an example app where we can choose the number of bins for this histogram in here, for example. And you can open it in your browser as well. So it's basically a web app, but now it's running locally on my computer. And if we are later ready to do so, we can publish it using this publish button, and then it will run, well, not now. And then it will run on, for example, the RStudio server when you're using RStudio Connect, for example. So we load the Shiny package and the fluid page is going to be created. There's always two things to a Shiny app, and this is the UI, the user interface, and the server function. Well, technically there's a third thing, and this is everything outside of these functions. This is the global part, which just runs whenever you start up the app. The UI defines the user interface. The server is the function that continuously runs when a user looks at your app. There's special things in Shiny app, and this is this concept of reactivity. For example, the render block function is reactive in the sense that if something changes in here, like for example, the X in here. It will know that something changed if it's if this something is declared to be also reactive, and it will react to it and automatically rebuild the plot. So in here, for example, it is looking at the input bins, and input is defined in here. Whenever you decide you make an input, like the slider input, you will get this list called input with the name bins in here. So whenever the slider changes, this render plot function will know, oh, something changed, and it's reactive to that, so it will re-render the plot. So a couple of things to do. First of all, we want to get basically everything that we did in here into the into our app. I want the diverse in here. I also want the fast food data in here. Of course, we are not printing it straight away, we're just loading it in. And we also want, we probably want this plot. Let's see what happens to it. And we also want the web scrape data. We, of course, we don't want to do the web scraping inside of the app. This would take an insanely long time to load up. But we want these complaints. Actually, everything we did after actually downloading the data was pretty fast. So we can, I think it's fine if we do this at the start of the app. Should be fine. Otherwise, we could have saved this to a data file and then loaded it. Or let me restart R so we get a fresh start, basically. It's a couple of things we need to change. Remember I told you the working directory of a Markdown document is always the place where it lives. But for normal R files, this app.r, let me actually just move it upwards one directory. So we only get this app.r file, not this whole app folder. Now the working directory for normal R files is the top level of the project, so we will need to go into / lectures, lecture 8. And I think this should, no, this did not work. We are getting the data. And then this one here needs to be a capital X. This is why it failed. I think I actually, did I accidentally convert everything to lowercase? I think I did. Oh, I also don't have this restaurants column in here. So we need these. And we also need these restaurant names. Right, now our plots are working again. We can load the data, we can get the top complaints. Okay, this is working. So now we replace this example app with something actually for our use cases. In the sidebar panel, I want a select input. This is the idea, and we are calling it restaurant. And the label is going to be pick your poison, I guess. And the choices are going to be no. Yeah, the unique restaurants, okay. And let's remove this plot output for now, so we don't need this. And let's run this and see if it runs. And it doesn't, because fast food CSV does not exist in the current working directory. Weird. So apparently it does. RStudio seems to be a bit confused, and R seems to be a bit confused about the working directory. So I'm actually going to use the here package, which will always reliably start at the root of our project, independent of what we're using. So this will create the correct file path for us. Yeah, this works. Now we can select these things, okay? Cool. And this one should be somewhere else. Let's do this. Let's create a function from it. Let's call it makeplot. And makeplot will take the name of the restaurant. And it will also, yeah, it will just do this here. And filter for the name of the restaurant. Let's see if the function worked. This is not what we expected, because all these are the same names. So I renamed this, and now it should filter for only one restaurant. Yeah, okay, cool. It's looking better. So this works, proof of concept. So let's make this plot in the app. So we need a plot output. Let's call it main plot. And let's leave it at that. It's just one output in the main panel. And now in here, we need to assign something to the output. And this is going to be this reactive thing. We want render plot. It takes an expression. So let's, because we're using multiple lines, use curly braces here. Make plot of input and input restaurant. let's run this whole thing. Save it, run it. And now what we should see is we can pick a plot here. And we don't actually see any output. And I think I found the culprit. I called the plot output main PLT. And in here I assigned to an output called main plot. But you'll just remove this O and run the app again. We should see a plot popping up here. It does, okay. And now we can change and get a different restaurant. Apparently there's no vitamin A and vitamin C for poaching, okay. I'm not going to go into how to style these and make it look more pretty, but what we do want to do now is add another output. Actually, let me add it here first. And I think I'm just using a text output. And call it top complaints. And in here, in the server function, we of course need a render text expression. And what we do want to render is, well, these top complaints, we want to filter so that the restaurant is equal to input restaurant. And then pull out, actually, let me test this down here. So we got the top complaints. If I pull out the let's use Arby's for now. Let's get only Arby's. Pull out the words, okay. Maybe you can present them a bit nicer. I think cut just pastes them together. Let's use a semicolon and a space. Yeah, it's looking good. Let's see how it looks. Output not found. Okay, this is a valid complaint. It was in line 86 output. Looks like I made a mistake again. Render text is not outputting anything. Should be here, text output, render text. Oh, it already does cat, okay. We can specify the separator as an argument to this here. This is why it only ends up in the console and not in the app. Okay. So we have a little app where you can pick a fast food chain. You get some nutritional information about the distribution across different items and the top complaints. And I didn't go into styling and all that, but this is how you would build a very simple and straightforward Shiny app using R. And we could then publish this using, for example, shinyapps.io. Let me quickly go over the difference between a Markdown and a Shiny app, for example. What do we want to publish? Don't need that. We need that. We don't need these. Don't need these, actually. Only these ones. So the difference is when you are knitting in a Markdown document and you end up with, for example, HTML, this should not be a problem because I'm not publishing it. So when you are giving a Markdown document to someone, and it has some interactive things like, for example, using JavaScript with the Plotlier library, this will just run locally in their browser, so they don't need to have R installed or running. However, Shiny apps, they need this R server that does things in the background, so it only runs when you're actually running it using R. Or when you are deploying it, this is what we're doing right now, you are deploying it to run on other people's server. For example, in this case, it's running on our studio server. Then the user doesn't need anything installed, the likes of R either. But so yeah, in terms of quickly sharing something, you usually always want a Markdown. The main difference is in here we can basically run any R code that we want, and in our Markdown everything needs to have already run. So our Markdown is like a final report, and Shiny apps can run any R code that you want, and you can make a little app from it. So it takes a while because it needs to install all those packages up here on the server that we are deploying to. So it's enough for another sip of tea. And let's hope and pray that my internet connection doesn't go away again. Alright, looks like there do is a bit of a mishap going on with the file paths, because when it's deployed, it's not able to find the data. And I think this is because the way it uploads the data, it seems to make this the new starting directory. So this here, I guess, needs to go when we deploy it, it needs to go away. There should be a more elegant way to do this, but just for a quick demonstration, let me just publish it this way. Now the disadvantage is now it doesn't run locally, because locally it's done these nested file structure down in your lectures, lecture 8, app.arm, but when it's deployed it will be at the root, so it won't have these files up here. You don't usually have these problems if you just create an app. instead of embedding it in a complete website that is also a course structure and also has all the other elements of course, so don't worry too much about it. Oh, we didn't change the title and all that. I guess we should have done so in here, title panel, but our app is running. But that should be it for today. I'm actually excited to see what you will build in the future. If you build something cool, you can always, of course, share it. In the Discord server, it will still be up. This is all from me, and I wish you all the best in your future journey with data analysis and R and statistics. So I'll see you next time.